So we need to talk about the different types of chemical bonds. Chemical bonds are going to form because they lower the potential energy between the charged particles that compose atoms. I've mentioned this before. Chemistry is driven by energy, and things are trying to get into the lowest energy state. I do have two teenagers. It's just a different two that are two teenagers. I have two teenage boys and a 21-year-old who, acts like a teenager sometimes. What do teenage boys, what's their natural lowest ground state? It's flat out in bed. Okay, texting, watching a movie, listening to tunes, or sawing logs. They sleep a lot. It's like, where's Zach? Oh, he's asleep. He actually fell asleep in the dentist's chair yesterday. He's pretty proud of that. While they were working on him. That's the ground state. They're going to low energy. They get up and do stuff. Zach gets up and rides his bike to the packing shed and works 9 or 10 hours. Rides his bike home in the heat. He comes home, takes a shower, and he's out, right? Low energy. Tommy gets up and goes to football practice. Exerts himself, but then he comes back. Low energy state. Okay, so everything's trying to go to those lower energy. Things roll down hills. They don't roll up hills. So it's all about the energy and going to lower energy. We have all these interactions between these particles in the atoms. We've got electrons. Electrons repel each other. Like charges repel. Nuclei are positively charged. They repel each other. And then we have attractions between the electrons and the nuclei. So we've got these competing attractions and repulsions. And a bond will form if those interactions result in a net reduction in energy. If they combine in a way that energy is lowered, that will happen. If combining and making a bond raises the energy, not going to happen. So ionic bonds we've talked about. Metals have low ionization energies. We talked about that yesterday. Ionization energy is the energy required to remove an electron. Metals lose electrons and form cations. Nonmetals have negative electron affinities, and they will tend to gain electrons to form anions. So what happens is the metal transfers electrons to the nonmetal, resulting in a positive ion and a negative ion, and then there's an attraction between those. Here's a summary of the three kinds of bonding we're going to talk about. So ionic bonding is between metal and nonmetal, and it's electrons transferred. Covalent bonds are between nonmetals, electrons shared. And metallic bonding is between metals only, and there the electrons basically are pooled. We talk about the sea of electrons. We'll get into details about that. In a covalent bond, this is going to happen between nonmetals. We're not going to get a transfer of electrons from one to the other because they both want to be anions. They both want to gain an electron. So what they're going to do instead is they're going to share. So they share electrons between. And by sharing, they are bonded together. So the most stable arrangement is when those shared electrons are between the two nuclei, because that's the lowest potential energy. So if we think about these two red circles here as being nuclei, and this is the electron that's being shared, if we put the electron up here, or if we put it over here, that does not maximize the attractions. You get maximum attraction, lowest potential energy, when it's between them. And so that's going to be the most stable. The electrons being shared between the nuclei is what holds them together. And that's how covalent bonding works. Metallic bonding is only between metal atoms. As we saw from the photoelectric effect, metals lose electrons fairly easily. If you shine light on them, you can get them to kick off electrons. Metallic bonding, we're not going to go into a lot of details But this is what I want you to understand. This very simple model of metallic bonding, which is called the electron C model. The idea here is that the atoms are in a metal lattice, so there is a long-range geometrical order, a pattern. This is a crystalline structure. And all of the atoms in there pool their valence electrons. Okay, so you could imagine like a neighborhood and the different families are the different electron atoms. And they all send their oldest children, the valence electrons, out to play in the neighborhood. Go out and play. And where are those electrons? Well, they're going all over the place. They do not have to stay in their own yard. They can go to the neighbors. They can go down the block. They're free to roam. That's how it was when I was a child. It was good. It was very good. So they pool their electrons. Those electrons then become delocalized over the entire metal, and they are free to move around, and that's why metals can conduct electricity. Well, what's holding it together? Well, you've got positive nuclei, because they sent a couple, one, two, three electrons out to play. You got the positive nuclei, and then you've got this pool, this negative sea of electrons, and there's attraction there, and that's what holds metals together. It's very non-directional. That's why metals are malleable and ductile. You can hit metal really hard and it may dent, but it's not going to shatter because there's attraction in all different directions, and so it can just bend and move. And that doesn't happen with an ionic solid where the interactions are very directional.